Welcome to Sacramento County Office of Education Leadership Institute, a panel presentation for the hiring process for principals with Management for Teaching and Learning by Linda Strom, Dr. Steve Winlock. Panelists are Joanie Cunningham, Mary Helen Fitch, Marc Nigel, Marc Rickabaugh. It's produced by Nick Barton, Rob Kinder, Barbara Modlin, Patrick McIntosh, and Ken Brown.
We have four really amazing people on our panel here. Each one of these folks has a unique perspective on our topic, which is how to land your first administrator job. So our four panelists, I'm going to just introduce their names, and I'm going to ask them to give you a kind of a brief bio on themselves and their history as it relates to our topic. This is my boss, Joanie Cunningham. So. This is Marc Nigel, Mary Helen Fitch, and Marc Rickabaugh. So, Joanie, I'll start with you. If you could actually just introduce yourself and your title and whatnot to the group. Thank you.
I am Joanie Cunningham. Yes, it's really Cunningham. Start with that, and I said that my brother-in-law's name is Richie, and yes, he says
no!
After hours, I will tell you the rest of the story, but I had Mary. So, I am the principal at Sandra J. Gallardo Elementary School in Unified School District. I've had the pleasure of being with Wilson Cordova for 17 years, and this is my ninth year as an administrator. I am pleased to be part of the board meetings. What Wilson Cordova has is called the Administrator Seminar Series, and I've actually worked with what's the center, Marc Rickabaugh, in the past at this process, and we are working with aspiring and current administrators who are wanting to network and gain more ground. So I helped to coordinate that fantastic. Led me to be a part of several interview panels for a variety of positions in our district. So I have been on interview panels on both sides, and I'd much rather interview than be the interviewer than the interview. So that's my little world.
Well, first, thanks for having me. I'm Marc Nigel. I'm the director of the Court School, Alternative Education, and Business Development for At-Risk Youth for Sacramento County Office of Ed. Before that, I was the director of the Court Community School Program in Placer County for a few years. Before that, I was a principal in Placerville for 3 years at Markham Middle School, and I was an assistant principal in Rose. So, thanks for having me.
Well, I'm Mary Helen Fitch, and I'm the youngest in the group. Actually, I need to tell you a little secret, and I hope it's okay. Linda Strom, your instructor at the present time, was my very first vice principal. Do you remember?
Thank you.
Well, I should clarify that. I was principal, and she was the vice principal, whom I was supervising. I've done a lot of things in my life, and let me tell you before we finish up, no, I'm not from Texas, so don't ask me that. I know that you're sitting there wondering what it is in my accent, but I'm not from Texas. I am from the Southeast and from Tennessee. A long time ago, but I can't get rid of this southern accent. I've taught several grades, mostly 2, 3, a little bit in 4, a little bit in kindergarten. We started and then had to disband the class. We're not up with students. Sixth grade, I have been a vice principal. I served in curriculum development for 9 years. Married a man from California, came here, and started work in Elk Grove, where I was a principal. And I didn't have to go and be a teacher again and a vice principal again to be a principal. So that was good. And then I became, in my final years in the work world, in terms of continuous employment, director of certificated personnel in Elk Grove Unified School District, from which I retired and began to work with Dr. Winlock in SCOE in the Institute Leadership.
Hi, I'm Marc Rickabaugh, and I'm retired. I just retired last June, and before that I was a few years at Folsom Cordova Unified. I ended up with a number of experiences, principal of a couple schools, and a lot of time in the personnel department. And then elementary schools, even supervised Joanie and her crew. And before that, I was a principal of a K-8 school. That's an adventure. And I taught also. Spent a lot of time looking for the best and the brightest teachers and classified and administrators. This would be a bailiwick of mine. I'm really glad to be here. I'm really glad to see so many familiar faces and you folks aspiring to be administrators. It is not an easy job. So good for you guys.
Well, thank you for joining us. So we're going to ask a series of questions, and so you can answer each of them and choose to answer them in whatever they are. If one calls you, then go ahead and answer it first. Give you a specific question. So we're going to start with to get the interview, we have to go through the paper screening process, right? So what we want to hear from you first, if we could, please, is first question is, what kind of experience do you recommend being highlighted on our resumes? What do you want our resumes to look like? What? Yeah.
Well, I'll start. I want to know lots of experiences, but I will tell you what I personally like to see. Remember, there are all kinds of formats for resumes. And your resume needs to be set up to present who you are. If your goal is to be a principal in a K through three setting, and you know that that's the position for which you are applying, I would say that's your goal. Goal, principal of a K-3 elementary school. Then maybe you'll apply somewhere else and you'll say, well, principal of a K-6 elementary school. But if you know there are a variety of positions that you may be ending up possibly interviewing for, then you'll have to figure out how you want to say what that goal is. That would not make me throw your resume or your packet in the trash can, but I do like to know what it is that you're thinking about wanting to do. If you do a lot of cut and pasting, as you do resumes, remember to take out those things that don't relate to the place that you were interviewing at before, because there's nothing more frustrating for me to find that you haven't really done your homework. And as you've done your cut and pasting, you need to be focused on the position that you're interviewing for. And one other thing that I like to see is when you're addressing your experiences, the assumption is maybe at this point that you are going to be a principal for the first time. Therefore, you don't have any principal background. What I would like for you to do is to set up your first category within your experiences, leadership roles. Because if you've been a leader of various committees that you've been given the responsibility for helping guide people, helping them arrive at decisions, then that's some good experiences for you. So I would like you to call that leadership roles. And I'd probably like to see that first. And again, individuals like different things when they go to look at your resumes, but I'm telling you what I would like. And then I'd like to see all of your teaching experiences, and do list them in the last experience that you've had. List that first and go to back to your earlier experiences. If you have experiences, I don't know everything in the world that you've done, but if you have some experiences that are very much supportive or has given you some extra experience becoming a teacher even, you can list those. It might be that you were a super, and so you might call those other experiences, or if you want to give it a more specific name, you could. You were a manager of five staff at McDonald's. Well, that helps me know that you have, in the other world, you've also had a little bit of leadership responsibility. That's if you want to, you don't have to list that. I don't think I'd be interested in knowing that you've done pole dancing. That's it. Those are my suggestions for resumes coming to you.
Unless it's for a PE something.
Oh, oh yeah.
Yeah, I would agree. I think that it's hard at the beginning because you don't have the experience of being a principal, but if you can do your homework and find out what the priorities are of the school, and if you have anything of your experiences that match those priorities, to list those in the beginning, because that's going to get somebody to keep on reading. When you're going through, I mean, it's very competitive right now. There's just, you know, when jobs open up, there's a lot of people that apply, and so you're looking for that match. Who's somebody that I want to find out more and just put in this pile right now? And then you might dig deeper a little bit later. But right now in the beginning, you get a stack and you're thinking yes or no. So you're almost looking for, give me the reason to say no, so I can, you know, I have my 10 people now or 15 people that I can go through. So whatever matches the school and individualized, I think is important, because EdJoin is also so easy that a lot of people have generic letters and they say, oh, here's a job, boom, I apply. And it's really easy on that to say, oh, this person, you know, it's, they're applying for a middle school job here and it says elementary. So.
I have another question. Did I catch somebody? Another question we have is, and you were just starting to talk about what are some common deal breakers that you've seen in the paper screening process that get your application diverted into the trash, and you just kind of alluded to a couple right there, but if you can sort of kind of expand on that. We're all going to be newbies competing with some real competitive jobs. Can you think of something that would give somebody with less experience a little bit more, maybe they would appear more desirable over some more experience?
I will speak briefly to the deal breaker component. What reading paper screening is, you have stacks of things, and we speak of which we know, misspellings or contact information that's incorrect, sayonara. Believe it or not, those still come through as educated as we are and as experienced as we are. I think it comes back to that cutting and pasting when we're usually mass doing something, but it's more offensive, I believe, in my position and opinion, to get something, especially somebody applying for a leadership position that has not taken the steps to double check that. So that is a number one thing to really pay attention to. I just want to throw that out there for sure.
Spelling is number one, absolutely, positively. Especially if you're saying, dear Mr. Rickabaugh, and spell my name wrong. I'm not kidding. If people have no attention to detail in something with all the time in the world like a resume, they're not going to be very good on the job. And so you just file it. You're done. So, and format of the resume, regardless of the content, if it's too short or if it's too long or if it's off a typewriter, or if the font isn't complimentary, it's not indented gracefully. First impressions, I gotta tell you, it's huge. If you see someone with a really polished, nice presentation, maybe that person's gonna be that way. You see someone who casually throws it together, that's the way they're gonna be. Those really are deal breakers. They're not, well, let's meet this person anyway. No, it's you're done. And remember, you're not going to get a job from a resume. There's one purpose for a resume. What is it? Get an interview. So remember that. Don't sweat it. Just make it pleasant. And going back to the first question, we're moving away from generalists. We really are. Back in the day, when Steve and I were just kids, you could be an all-around administrator type person and we move from level to level. And what I've watched through the years is we're becoming specialists. So when they're looking for an administrator, chances are they're looking for someone with middle school specialties or elementary or lower elementary or even preschool or secondary or adult ed and alternative ed. They really are looking for specialists, not all around just good old people. So when you present your resume, you have to present yourself as a specialist and a leader amongst your peers. The leadership role can't be overemphasized. It's great that you're on a committee, a curriculum advisory committee, for example. I was on CAC for 5 years. Really, what did you do? What'd you do? Just clock in, or were you a chair? You're a chair for CAC, that's really important. Does that make sense? A volunteer's nice. A leader on a committee is huge.
You know, another thing, in large districts, getting past getting to the actual stack that might where you might be interviewed, we're fortunate enough that in the large districts, we might have some people who will do certain kinds of screening before they ever get to the stack. And I can tell you right now, if you don't have all of the elements or the documents that you should have attached to your application, unless you've got a really good reason, they may not make it to the stack for the for me to look through to decide if I want to interview. So if in your cover letter, I don't know of any place that you wouldn't have a cover letter to your application, you could say, because of having finished my class of blah blah, there are two documents that have been requested and I will bring those immediately if you have to do that, but not speak to the issue in the garbage can. You may not get an interview.
Great, okay, thanks guys. So we got the interview. So now we want to hear from you on that if we could. So next question, so what qualities make the best first impression in an interview? So basically, how can we walk in and right away show you that we're the right person for the job? Best way we can achieve a good first impression.
I was told many years ago by some very, I believe smart people, it's the first 20 seconds of an interview that is that sets the stage. It's the first 20 seconds. And I believe strongly with what the panel's saying as well, your resume is one component of you coming in the door. Do I like you? Am I going to listen to you? And part of that is just who you are and how you present yourself, your comfortability. And if you're ever not nervous in an interview, you're probably not alive. So you need to be nervous. You need to have that piece. That's the good thing. But a really connecting with each panel, each person. It could be a one-on-one. It could be a panel interview. Can you sort of keep in mind, you don't know who those, assuming you don't know who those people are. Most of the time, you would assume people are going to introduce themselves and their role or their position at that school. Have you ever seen the show Undercover Boss? Love it. Keep it in your mind at all times. Because you don't know who's in charge of what and who knows who and who goes where. So everybody on that panel needs to be treated with the same amount of respect, I think, and consideration at all times. It would just be my biggest. I've had from custodians to secretarial staff to kitchen, sitting on a variety of things depending on what we need. And it's interesting where I've actually seen people maybe just focus in on the other person versus they're there for a reason. We are a business, we're a school. So be thinking of the entire panel, I think is a great suggestion.
And I chime in on that as well. I think it's you know, interviewing is definitely an art. I think people need to be prepared for it when you walk in the door. But first impressions are big, you know, how you greet everybody. And a lot of times you get in there and you might be nervous and somebody asks you a question. So you focus on that one person and you direct your entire answer to that person, where if you sat on this side of the panel before you walked in the door, we're like, how are we going to do this? All right, you read the first one, I'll read the second one, and it'll go right through. But everybody is evaluating and judging that answer. And so it's how you treat everybody in there, I think, is extremely important. The confidence that you have. And I think the first thing to do is, you know, I like it when people kind of take over the interview. It's a kind of a balance, because like what Marc said about the resume, all right, how do you know if it's too long or how do you know if it's too short? You know, which one is the just right. And it's kind of the same thing in the beginning, is you don't want to come in like you own the place, but then again, you don't want to come in real timid either, you know. So taking over the interview by maybe thanking them for the opportunity before you can get started with your first answer, and also anticipate, because most likely your first question is going to be something about, tell us about your background and experiences that relate to this position, or something like that. And it's amazing to me when you ask that question and you're like, did they not practice that? Like, did they not think that this question was coming? You know, and I think that if you can be prepared, because, you know, when I sit on that interview panel, I'm like, do I have to listen to question two or am I done? You know, the first question doesn't get you the job, but it makes people continue to listen, or it's like, all right, I'm done and let's move on. So
I'd like to add on to what Marc was saying about making eye contact. When the person asks you, the person who's asking a particular question, look at them, receive the question, and begin your question by the first part of your question by continuing to look at them, but not the whole time, just as you start. And then pan all of the committee. And when you get ready to close your answer, go back to the person who asked it, because remember, they're going to close and say thank you or whatever, so that the next person can ask their question. There have been times when I wasn't really sure when the candidate was through because they were still looking over here, and I'm just, and you're afraid to jump in or butt in. So if you can remember that in your nervousness, because I understand you will be nervous, but just sort of practice that. Finish your answer, even if it's only three sentences long. Go back to your question person, the first one.
I wanted to say too, and not to keep pointing on Marc, but Marc's seen me in a variety of interviews as well through the years. The panel knows, we know that you're nervous coming in. Don't hide that, you know, to the extent of, if you're not nervous, you're allowed to be nervous. You're not going to get a job because you're nervous. You're going to not get the job maybe because you're answer, or you didn't say what you said, but it's not because you're nervous. So even the greatest have sat and tried to almost be too stoic and do not show their nerves. You're human. You're nervous. It is. It's awful, but it's also great. And again, it's okay to be nervous.
I'd like to just, all this is right, and I would like to add one little thing about dress. I wore these clothes today purposefully. One, because I'm retired. Another reason was I thought maybe this was a Saturday and maybe it was a more casual atmosphere. But I wanted to wear these clothes to say, I've interviewed people walking into for a principalship wearing Levi's and tennis shoes. And I got to tell you, I'm done when I shake their hands, because if you walk in a tuxedo, you're inappropriate. If you walk in like I am, I had a guy interviewed for vice principalship in shorts and sandals, and I knew this person, outstanding individual, but he was just sort of interviewing us. Made the worst impression on the other three. It took me months to do damage control. Okay, so what you wear is important. What you wear is to not draw attention to yourself. I mean, don't wear beige, but is that what the mother of the groom is supposed to wear? But anyway, you don't want to be too dressed up, and you certainly cannot dress down. And if you wear things that draw attention to your body or your feet or something, it's a problem. So it's professional, clean, and crisp. And the other thing that I'll just close with is, this is one of the few things in an administrator interviews that really is applicable. Administrators make first impressions a lot. And if you're gonna put somebody in the position to be an administrator at a school site or a program, they find themselves in first impression opportunities often. So it is important what your first impression is like. And your first impression is when you walk through the door and when you say thank you and you're leaving. The whole thing is a first impression.
Yeah.
So this is an important event for an administrator. It's not just what you know, it's who you are and how you act.
If perchance you go totally blank in the interview, then you nearly swallow your tongue. It's always appropriate to say, excuse me, would you ask me that question again? Or would you repeat that question, please? And what that does, it gives you a little bit of time to sort of draw some rest moments there, and it is moments, but sometimes the thoughts will come to you when you ask them to repeat the question. It's okay to do that. And they will probably repeat the question just as they repeated the first time, because I'm sure you've heard that when you go into interviews, you cannot ask different questions of candidates. Mm-hmm. They have to be the exact same questions. Now, inflection and tone and all, that might be a little different for each one, but they're still going to be the same questions. Okay, for them to repeat the same question to you.
And then the last thing just about that first impression, sorry, is, you know, the first question, as we mentioned, you kind of have an idea of basically what it's going to be about, and somebody's going to set it up and say, we have 10 questions in 30 minutes or 10 questions in 45 minutes. So from the first question, you answer in a minute and a half, probably not appropriate. Or if you're going on and on and on the first question, you know, it's, you just need to be very aware of the time, and you need to practice. And you need to practice out loud.
They could help. See, the idea is gone. Careful on what you talk. One thing, and I don't know if this is one of the questions that we'll cover, but it just dawned on me too. Occasionally you'll serve on panels because you're in districts now, and you may serve on a panel, or you may be interviewing the panels of people that you know. Mm-hmm. And sometimes you think, yeah, that's so great, because so-and-so's going to be on. Sometimes it can be much more difficult. Mm-hmm. So the other part to that I just would like to add is, don't underestimate yourself that somebody knows you. If you're sitting with a panel of people that happen to have worked with you a variety of things in the years, through the past, whatever it might be, pretend as though you are just reintroducing yourself. Do not make any assumptions that people will know how great that activity was or how responsible you were in this way. This is your time to shine, because odds are somebody else will not know you. So cater your answers to the person potentially who doesn't know you. With that, again, that comfortability level, you know, make sure that you're still professional going in, from your dress to how you're addressing people. You probably don't want to go nicknames right away, just coming in. Again, we speak of which we know, where people get way too comfortable too fast when they're walking in and kind of sit in position. Again, your body language speaks tons too. So how you're positioning yourself, this is considered, again, it's a one-time, more than likely a one-time shot. They put a lot of work into selecting a candidate. You need to be, you just make sure you are receptive of that and also answering and presenting very professionally.
You know, that question that usually gets asked, the very first question, tell us a little bit about yourself. And I'm thinking to myself as I'm sitting there on the panel, getting ready to listen, my God, there were like 15 things, experiences they gave us in the application packet. Why do I want to hear all of that repeated again? Well, maybe I don't want to hear it repeated again. What I might like for you to do, and part of that is to get you to relax, because you know who you are, you know about yourself. You might be able to say, in addition to the things that I shared with you in my application, I think here are some other things that I would like to share with you. Because number one, that's a cue. If somebody hasn't read that packet, you know, the panel, they can go back and see that, but you might want to share some other things. So you think about how you might want to handle that.
Here's another one.
That was so
good. When you're thinking about go-to questions that have been particularly helpful in shedding light in your decision making, can you think of a couple one or two questions?
I got some for this. So, you know, if you were applying for a job and we were prepping tomorrow, I would probably ask, what are the questions or the categories they're going to ask you in? And so you would list off these categories. You know, they're going to ask you something about instruction, something about budget, something about personnel, something about getting parent involvement, you know, your standard questions, which leaves a few specific ones to the school. And so you want to find out what are their priorities. You know, can you do your homework and find out how their test scores? Are they in program improvement? If so, what might be a plan to get them out? You know, you want to anticipate kind of the questions that they're going to be. But the best advice that I was given when I was applying for my first job, and I didn't have a lot of experience, my first principal job, my superintendent at the time said, you know, the last question, they always say, you know, do you have any questions for us? And he said, you know, and my superintendent was a great guy. He goes, so if you ask a question that I thought you should know the answer to, I'm thinking, you know, didn't you do your homework? You know, you can't find that on the website, or you don't know how many kids we have at this school, or you don't know where we're located, you know, whatever it might be. And then if you ask me a question that puts me on the spot, I'm like, well, who's interviewing him, you know, here? So he said, I always looked at this like in a lawyer's closing argument. You know, if you sat on a panel at the end of the day, you're going to leave and we're going to discuss you. And we're going to discuss why yes and why no. And if there's something that you maybe, this is your chance to speak to that while you're not in that room. So for me at the time, it was that I didn't have a lot of experience. I had never been a principal before. You know, I was an assistant principal for a couple years and I only had 5 years of teaching experience. So I needed to address that. Although that experience is not going to determine if I'm going to be a successful leader or not, but what is are these qualities, and then how, whether it was here or when I was a pole dancer, how I was going to go ahead and, you know, that was going to make me successful, whatever it might be, you know. And I think that it's really important at the end to, you know, I like it. It's like the first question, you know, is really solid, and then this is what you're ending with, and this is why we should kind of choose you in an appropriate way, you know. And so it's kind of reading the room. It might be a good opportunity at that time if you didn't answer something as well as you would have liked to, and this is a chance to kind of add something. But, you know, to kind of prepare your closing argument of why you. You know, they're getting 30 or 40 applications. They're narrowing it down to 8 to 10 to interview. And then they're going to maybe bring it to a second round interview, which might be 1 to 3. And, you know, why should we choose you? What's going to make the difference? And I think if you have a really strong last name there, you're prepared for it, that can help you.
I know that, excuse me, I said ditto. Mm-hmm.
Some of us more experienced, really experienced principals, when we're doing individual interviews, even though we know we still have to use the same questions as it applies to the same position. We tend to, and everybody has done a wonderful job, and maybe there's just another thing or two I could find out about. We may ask something that is nonsensical seeming to you. So, what we might be looking for is how quickly you think on your feet and what process you're using. One might be, let's say we've hired you, we give you $100, and you can go buy 3 items, but you have to do it within 24 hours. Tell me what you would buy and why. There is no correct answer, but I'd be curious what maybe they might be going through to make a decision. It doesn't pass or fail you. It just gives another picture. So don't be surprised if somebody did that somewhere along the way. And Dr. Winlock, maybe Linda would probably know who those people might be when ask those kinds of questions. But be prepared, you never know.
Don't get hung up on what the questions are gonna be. Focus on concepts and topics and general areas so that you can talk about it. And don't be like, you know, all these people in the last few months where you ask a question and they answer something else. I'm sorry, that wasn't good. But what I most enjoyed watching people do is when they tell me something. I was trying to think of a good example. So you're an administrator and this is your school, and you walk into a classroom and you know this is a good classroom. Tell me what. And then I get to watch you process. I get to watch you process what you appreciate in a teacher, the way it's set up, the way the kids are reacting. If you're seeing the whole picture, if you're like on a basketball team and you're the point guard where you see all of your players and all of their players all at the same time, everybody moving, kind of like this little concert, then that's the type of person I was looking for. If you're real focused on what the bulletin boards say today, then maybe that's a little narrow-minded. So my favorite kind of question that I liked was, tell me questions. And then let it be open-ended. Just tell me what you would do with $100. And it's watch as you process and watch you think out loud. And so be ready to process and think out loud. Purpose of the interview is to let them know who you are. It's not to get a bunch of answers correct. It's not to play a game. And if some interview panel comes up with like trick questions to see, you don't want to work for those people. Go to another district. Well, the purpose of an interview is to get to know you. And so go in there saying, you know what, by the time I leave, they're going to know who I am. And that's how you communicate and express yourself and tell about things and reflect and problem solve out loud and those types of things. So those are, I like the questions that, but be careful, every once in a while they throw in a yes or no question. If they say yes or no question, say yes or no. And then go to the next question. Because we're going back to the first impressions. I got to tell you, this actually happened. We asked this person, the first, tell us about yourself. Why are you ready for this job? And he just started going off. And a panel member said, well, we have other questions. I said, you know, let's let him finish. And I go, okay. And I didn't want this guy as the principal. I mean, I knew going in, I did 20 minutes.
Wow.
Answering the first question on who he is and why he's so special. It made my job later easier. So first, just balance the whole interview process. Let them know who you are by the time you leave. And that way, if you're selected, it's a good choice. If you're not selected and they know who you are, it's a good choice for you.
So we all have weaknesses, but a lot of us get thrown off by that question that's making the weaknesses. What are we supposed to say? What are our weaknesses? Oh, I don't have any. Or, I revalidate first. You don't want to hear that we don't have any. So what is the solemn response if you ask that question, strengths and weaknesses? What are you hoping to hear? You know, obviously, you don't want to just make it up, but we want to know what the line is.
I think that's one to be really prepared for, because in some terminology that question's going to come through. And I think honesty is huge. When somebody again just goes, and we all know what so start to think, what area would I really, maybe it's curriculum development. I haven't had much opportunity to actually implement a curriculum, and I'd love to learn more about. Have something that you feel comfortable with. Maybe it is discipline, but you probably would say that. But you want to have something to say to yourself, don't you? It's a hard question because you want to be honest about it, but you also are coming into that whole, the difficulty of, I don't want to penalize because I don't have experience, but I can't get experience because I don't have it's that whole cycle. So it's okay that you did, but what have you had experience that, and where in it, where in your career, short of you were having coffee and having that conversation, how would you answer that to somebody? I really would love to look at whatever it may be. Give me something that I would go, do it, because I don't want to do that, so I want you to. That's what I say.
Yeah, and I'm going to jump in real fast. This has never been a deal breaker. This question has never made or break someone in a job, even though we sweat over it. So, just turn it around on them. What are your strengths? Talk about things you feel expert in. I have implemented, I have done this, I have done something with gifted and talent, or I'm a Title I person, blah, blah, blah. And then the next one is, I look forward to learning more about. That way it's a power, it's a position of control. You know, my weakness is I can't make eye contact with adults. I mean, come on. So say it in what you look forward to in your next learning adventure is whatever. It's never, oh my gosh, can you believe the way that person answered the strengths weakness question? and somebody loses their job over it. I've never seen that. But it still watches you reflect. It watches you tell about yourself, which is what the interview is all about.
Who are you?
How can you talk about yourself? And that's what you get to do for a minute. So think of it as a positive moment, and where you've been and where you're going to go, versus, oh my gosh, I'm going to be exposed for being a fraud. I'm the man behind the curtain in Wizard of Oz. That's not the purpose of the question.
I would align it, your challenge areas, I would align it to your least experiences, or within the context of where you've been or over the time, and try to come from the point of view that, well, let's say maybe you're taking a class already in helping yourself to grow in that particular area. And talk about how you're going to build that challenge area into a stronger area for yourself. Don't leave it, well, I'm just weak there. Talk about how you know you can build that into one of your stronger areas. But your strength, building it into a strength. And I still like the word challenge, because it's still challenging you to get somewhere.
Yeah, and I like the, there's so many different areas in leadership and school leadership that there's not one that I think anybody's an expert in. So I think that there's not an area that you wouldn't want to strengthen up. You know, you might have something you might want to highlight that you feel that you've had exposure to, or that just you're naturally, you know, you're a people person. This is a people business, and hopefully you're great with people. But, you know, when it comes to that weakness or you have to address it, you know, some people will start listing them off. You're like, really? And then, you know, the other part might say, you know, hey, I'm just really hard on myself. You know, one area that I would like to, I take school home with me. You know, I care about the kids. I care about my faculty. I care about that if I said something that somebody maybe misinterpreted, it bothers me. I lose sleep over it. It bothers me over a weekend. I can't wait to see that person, that whether it's a little person or a big person, the next day, and make sure that, you know, that we're good, because it bothers me. I care greatly about my job. You know, that might be an area to show that it's really a strength, but you're saying it's something that you want to work on, is to be able to balance it out.
And aside from the guy who walked in with flip-flops and shorts, is there an instance that you can share where somebody really did something peculiar or wrong in the interview?
Well, besides 20 minutes on the first question.
You know, I've had somebody come in and kind of rip the school or the district. That's not good.
Yeah, really, you're not becoming an administrator because the one you have is such a jerk. That's happened. People come in with a real arrogant point of view because I'm going to come in and fix this. Well, you know, who my principal was, Marc. And I'm going, well, you can't do that. You can't say you want to become someone at the district level because the last director was enough. You can't do that. That's what it is. Yeah, you have to go into it as it's an adventure, and it's something you get to impact more than my own classroom. You get to impact the whole school, or whatever the job is specifically. It's not to fix somebody else's mistakes. That's really hard one to listen to. But there's a lot of things you can do that. I seriously have one person who is extremely articulate, one of the brightest people in our school district, was applying for a position. It was a director position. She was, I don't know, she was great.
I can hear you.
Actually, currently, she's director of certificate personnel. She's director of personnel now. And she went into an interview, and she froze. And it was deer in the headlights, and you'd ask, Karen, what's your last name? And she stumbled with it. And tell us about, she was applying for the director of state federal the categorical programs. And she she just absolutely melted down in front of our eyes. And anybody that knows Karen Knight just doesn't expect that out of her. She's brilliant, and she's articulate, and she froze. So it happens. But the other thing is I've had the experience to mentor a lot of people after they crashed and burned in a moment like that. And so you need to feel comfortable with someone that you feel comfortable with. When they say, you know, if you want to talk about the interview process afterwards, feel free to contact me. Well, a number of people have. And after about the third or fourth interview, there's people in our district right now that are principals because of that. The way they've grown through the process and are able to express themselves and communicate. And so take advantage of those people that are legitimately offering a moment of reflection on how you did on the stage. The guy that wore that came in casual had no clue. And I said, do you just like offending people? What do you call it? It shocked him. He almost, you could see him welling up even. And then he never did that after. And actually for him, I didn't wait for him to ask for help. I went. I said, I'm going to give you some feedback. Sit down. And I was blunt. And you know what? He's never done that again. So yeah, there's some things you can do that are really dumb. Repeating the same expression over and over, like, well, you know, this is like the word like for a while. Oh my gosh. There will be people in the interview with a pen, and they'll be making hash marks on how many times you've cleared your throat or said So you have to be careful with those little silly things. And if there's someone like Joanie in the room, you just never know what she's thinking. And so just be careful with that kind of stuff.
I might be doodling. Really, do it. Remove filler words in your conversation or your discussion in the group. I like
it. It's some people just have a habit.
You know, every other breath, hash marks. We all do it. In casual conversations, we say it all the time, this person included, but when I catch myself saying it, get it out of my conversation. The more you practice leaving it out, the better you'll get at not using filler words.
Another one that started to really irritate me towards the end was, let's pretend you asked the question and I go through and explain it all. And at the end, I say, now, did that answer your question? And then the next person asks me a question, and I talk, and then, now, did that answer? Is that what you were looking for? I swear, people would do that in an interview. I wanted to just grab them by the throat. So if they ask me, now, did that, Mark, did that answer your question? Absolutely. Best answer I've ever heard. I would roll my eyes, and they go, okay, I got it. And they went and asked the question again, but don't do that. I mean, if you don't know, answered the question, don't expose yourself.
Listen, you said you were retired.
Yeah.
You guys don't have to worry.
They all these wholesome Cordova people know I have a sense of humor and also I'm not shy a lot, so we had fun with the process. Mm-hmm. It was never torture, I don't think. At least not for me.
No, we're out of time, but I want to say thank you very much to the panel. Hope I answered your question.
Did
that answer your question? I apologize. Thank you very much. It was great to have you come out here on a Saturday, but there's not much left of the day, but this was very informative to us.
Can I interject with one quick question?
Yes.
Did any of you have an unsuccessful interview application process in your journey to wherever you are, including retirement?
Every time I interviewed, I crashed and burned. I was the worst interviewer. Well, I mentioned one earlier.
So it wasn't all...
That was terrible.
You mean we didn't get the job?
Right. You applied for something, you didn't get it. Are you like the blessed ones that because you're so articulate and so... has such a great sense of humor.
I applied for a number of jobs, and I have a most difficult time patting myself on the back.
Okay.
And I would get tongue-tied, and I wouldn't articulate well, and I... The only times I got jobs or promotion is when people really knew me. It was a weird journey for me.
I interviewed for a very important job and didn't get it. But what I had to recall and think about was I competed with some very good candidates. And I personally went back and revisited things that they might have been able to do that I had not either spoken to, or it just turned out that that person was the better person for the job.
Mark?
So that's what you have to do.
I've been pretty fortunate. The one job I did not get, they offered me a different one. But I was lucky. So I don't know. I think I was going up against somebody else.
Mark's not real.
It's lucky though.
Within the last year, I had applied for a different position, and it was one of the hardest and worst and best things I've ever done in my career, because I'm not unhappy being a principal, but I thought there's got to be something else for me, and I'm this person, and shouldn't I? Heck of a journey, and I learned probably more than anything that I watched other people that didn't get the job with me, who I'm mortified to be a professional with from the way they handled it, not getting the job, because you need to remember, when you apply for a job, that's why it's called an application. It's not a, you're going to get hired. You are more than likely going to go up against other people, and I want them to pick the best person for this job. If I'm not, I mean, I'm pretty great, but if I'm not what they're looking for at that point, I have to be ready to hear that. Yes, you can be sad. Yes, you can be mad. And you know what? Go drink it. Whatever you need. But after that, really stop and go, okay, what can I do? When you ask the question to somebody like Mark said, and he has been my mentor for years, what did I do? What could I have done differently? You better be ready for somebody to answer you. Mm-hmm. Don't ask it unless you're ready to hear the answer, and then do something about it. That's just the best advice. So no, even the best, there's no such thing as a bad interview in the big scope of things. So even if you bomb, you're still gaining skills as you go along.
Thank you all.
One of the things that we will be offering to you all as participants, and this has really been very helpful, in January and in February, we will be doing a workshop around finding the job, the homework, preparation, and delivery. And so when you think about some of the comments that you all are making, it fits really well into it. We look at the cover letter, we look at the things that you do in your homework, we look at the things about the interview process. All of the things to look at you finding the job. So I just wanted to kind of underscore, and you all have just kind of helped very much so in kind of introducing. That'll be in January, it'll be, it's an optional part of your Saturday seminars, but it will be an optional that you can be a part of, and we'll give you 2 to 3 days that you can choose to be a part and come to that to get that information. It's a couple hours of
okay.
Sunday.
Thank you.
Thank you for joining us. We'd like to thank the Sacramento County Office of Education's Leadership Institute. We'd like to thank our special guests, Joanie Cunningham, Mary Helen Fitch, Marc Nigel, and Marc Rickabaugh. Hope you got some valuable information on how to go through the interview process and getting a job, and how to get an administrator's job through the process. Thank you.